This video is brought to you by Brilliant. 2 weeks ago, I released a video about my ultimate iOS 16 home screen, and in it, I featured a widget that has caused a lot of hype. Over 350,000 views later, there was one prevalent comment that stood out. I think it's time to show you how I created this widget. Instead of creating the same one, however, I decided to design something different that follows absolutely the same principle and structure. You can hopefully get inspired and create your own rendition by looking at both widgets. So grab your snacks, because this will be a longer than usual video, and let's dive in by first overviewing the Namib Desert widget. Oh, before I get too excited, I will pack the new widget in a product for those of you who don't like to tinker and just want to install it and support a creator while at it. Now, let's go back to the overview. I call this widget the Namib Desert. It comes with a bespoke wallpaper bundle for both the lock and the home screen, and it has 10 areas you can interact with. At the top, we have the current outside temperature with a dynamic weather icon that displays the weather conditions. Tapping on it opens the weather app. Below it is my beloved weekly calendar that shows the weekly days and dates, which is interactive. When tapping on it, it opens the calendar app. Inspired by the pill-shaped dynamic island on the iPhone 14 Pro, below the calendar I've placed a pill-shaped action bar, as I call it. It contains four quick actions that I most often use. The first one opens the home app, the second creates a new task in my to-do app, the third plays music, and the last is a very requested shortcut. It triggers an instant connection to my AirPods. Even if my AirPods are connected to another Apple device, I instantly bring that connection to my phone thanks to this shortcut. Below the action bar, I have four app icons that open the app they represent. And by the way, I really love how the depth effect turned out this time. Okay, so let's build it from scratch. And if you end up enjoying this video, subscribe, because why not? Okay, so if you decide to build your own interpretation of this widget, you can use the same overlapping principles I will show you. Make sure you use high-res images and transparent PNGs where necessary, like the clouds in the sky. If you want to build the exact same widget I have here, follow the DIY Namib widget link in the description below and purchase the inexpensive materials pack, which has all the bespoke hand-drawn and pre-cut components you'll need. If by any chance you choose not to build the widget, you'll still have access to awesome wallpapers to apply to your device. As I mentioned earlier, if you just want to go ahead and install this widget as is without having to tinker to build it, I also have a Namib widget complete pack ready for installation. It comes with the widget itself, all the components and wallpapers, as well as a step-by-step guide. So step number one, place the folder that holds the widget components in your iPhone Files app. Step two, save both wallpapers from the folder in your photo gallery ready to be applied. Step three, install the Widgie widget app from the App Store. Remember, feel free to pause the video whenever you need to catch up with the steps. Okay. So let's start simple by applying both the lock screen and home screen wallpapers. Ensure you position the wallpapers without stretching or cropping them, because they are vital to the overlapping effects that we will add later. If you have a smaller screen iPhone, make sure the wallpapers are aligned to the top, even if it cuts out on the bottom. Next, open Widgie widget and from the first tab select Create and scroll down to choose a large widget. I'll go to the third tab quickly, Document, and give this widget a name and description. Next, I will go to the Primary Manage tab of Widgie, where I will position my newly created widget in an empty slot to place it on the homepage. I am placing it in Large Slot 2, but you can put it anywhere you like. Next, I'll go to the homepage and add a new widget. From the widget options, I will select Large Slot 2. Going back to the widget from the Layers tab, we'll first add a new image layer. While having nothing in it, I will stretch that image to take the entire space of the widget, since it will hold a transparent background. This way, the widget won't have a black background like any other widget, but instead blend in. By the way, you can choose the steps or increments of the resizing and positioning elements by toggling between the small, medium, and large steps. Small come in very handy for some fine adjustments of the images later. Next, I'll go to the third tab of the image layer that we just created, and I'll scroll down to Widgie and choose transparent background, high quality. This will lead me to a screen where I need to place a screenshot of the home screen to simulate the current background that we have applied. To create this background, go back to the home page, place the icon on your home screen in jiggle mode for a moment, and swipe left to an empty home screen. Take a screenshot of this home screen and go back to widget to select it as a background. And just like that, the home screen already looks fantastic. This is where the fun starts. Before we do anything else, I will rename my first image layer to transparent background. I'm urging you to rename all your layers as you build the widget accordingly, so you can easily manage everything. You'll notice later that I will rename all my layers as I create them. The next layer is again an image that will hold my first icon. Once I add the layer, I'll go to the second tab Image and choose System and Files to locate the image I have prepared for my Notes app. Once I choose the image, I'll go to the last tab Effects and add Edge Rounding to the icon to match it with the rest of the iPhone apps. I find 20% to be the perfect amount of rounding. Then I go back to the first tab, Frame, and resize the image to 290 by 290 pixels. Then I'll position it all the way down and use these small steps to move it left and right and align it with the rest of the icons on the iPhone. Note that you can exit Widget and go to the home page at any time without having to confirm the changes inside the app to test how everything looks. This is how I eyeball if my icons are aligned. Once I'm happy with the position of the first icon, I will duplicate it 3 more times and align all 4 icons accordingly. Then I'll go to the 3 duplicated icons and choose the appropriate images from my files to represent the icons wanted. Some house cleaning is in order and I will rename all the layers accordingly. Next, I will add the little overlapping corner of the dark brown dune to overlap with the Notes app. This image is called Overlay 1 and it's inside the folder. Positioning this element takes a bit of time to look perfect, but I'm happy with the result a few minutes later. Feel free to take my size and positioning coordinates from this screenshot. Next, I will create my first tap layer. As you can probably guess, the tap layer allows you to tap on an area to trigger an event. In my case, I want to place the 4 tapping areas for the respective icons and trigger them to open the apps they represent. Setting tapping areas is very easy. Once positioned and resized, the tapping area gives you a list of official Apple apps or third-party apps that you can select from. But remember that not all apps are listed there. If the app you want to open is not there, you might want to change the app or maybe use a shortcut to open it. This will in fact happen to me in just a moment as I realize I'm not able to trigger the camera app. To avoid using shortcuts, I will replace the camera app with the YouTube app. Once I test everything, I will create a new group layer called Apps. I will place all my app images, overlay, and tap actions inside for easy management. Next, I will create a new image layer that will hold the second overlay of the other dune with the little camels. Fine-tuning the size of the layer comes in a bit later. Before that, I will create yet another layer for the calendar. Instead of a full calendar, I'll go to the calendar tab and choose compact mode, which will essentially summon the weekly calendar. Then I will resize it a bit and from the layers tab, I will place it below my second overlay dune to simulate the depth effect. Then I'll go to the calendar tab again and I will change the font and colors to my initial design. I'm using the Antonia font in bold for the days and the regular width for the dates. Everything is in black with a 20% shadow to add a bit of a dimension. Finally, I will change today's symbol color to light gray. Next is adding the current outside temperature. I will add a new text layer. From the last data tab inside the layer, I will choose weather now and I'll select feels like temperature. Widget takes that information directly from the weather app. I will position the temperature closer to the final spot and from the text tab, I will style the text accordingly. I ended up using the DIN condensed bold font in gradient black with again a 20% shadow. From the text tab, you can scroll down to disable the show unit feature, which will remove the Fahrenheit or Celsius text. Once I'm happy with the positioning and aesthetics of the temperature, I will add a new symbol layer to represent the outside conditions. From the symbol tab, select Apple SF symbols and scroll down to find the weather now symbols. I'll choose the solid fill symbol and give it a solid color by picking the brown from the sand dune. Then I'll give it a 20% shadow again and position it slightly over the temperature text for added depth effect. I'll combine all weather layers into a group folder for maintenance purposes and with that, we're almost ready with the widget. Well, almost. I'll need to add tap action layers for both the weather and calendar and lead them to open the respective apps. Time to create the action layer. For a start, I'll add an image layer that is the black bar. Initially, I made the black bar with transparent rounded edges. Still later, I figured I could simply use a normal rectangle and add rounded corners like we did with the icons on the bottom. To do that, you can go to the Effects tab and give the black bar edge rounding a 50%, which is the maximum in this case. Next, I will create four text layers that will read the quick actions that I most often use. Home, New Task, Play Music, and AirPods. Nothing complicated here. Simple text using the Antonio font and proper spacing and positioning. On top of the four text layers, I will place four tap action layers for each action. The first tap action opens the Home app. The second tap action triggers a shortcut that creates a new task in my To-Do app. The third triggers a shortcut that plays Apple Music. And the last triggers a shortcut to connect my AirPods to the iPhone. I will explain all four shortcuts in my Sunday newsletter, so make sure you're subscribed to it. I will place links to my newsletter up top and in the description below. To finish the widget, I will add the last overlay, an image of clouds that I drew. Add this image layer and resize it and position it to your liking. It should be on the very top of all the layers. In my case, I stretch it pretty much across the entire widget. And with that, the widget is ready, and I think it looks fantastic. See, when developing apps, or in this case this widget, I often use a systematic exploration approach, which is a handy problem-solving technique in computer science. Brilliant's course on computer science fundamentals helps me become a better thinker. A great example from a recent lesson I took is the city of Königsberg, which had seven bridges connecting two river islands in the city's heart. This arrangement made many wonder if it's possible to walk across every bridge exactly once, starting anywhere in the city. See, in computer science, computers can check possible solutions for lots of problems very quickly and don't get frustrated when the first few million don't work out. If you want to learn the fundamentals or improve your knowledge of core computer science concepts, check out this Brilliant course and the thousands of other lessons with exclusive new content that Brilliant as monthly. You don't have to spend 4 years and a fortune to understand this stuff. To get started for free, visit brilliant.org/thisis-e or click on the first link in the description below. The first 200 of you will get 20% off Brilliant's annual premium subscription. So there are a few ways you can customize the widget. First, you can enable or disable components to your liking. Since we grouped and named all layers responsibly, this takes just a second. For instance, you can hide the entire action bar or the calendar, or the weather portion. If you'd like to change any of the four icons, you have to find the images of your desired icons. I have icon packs on my store, but you can simply Google and find anything you want. Make sure they're square and preferably sized 1024 by 1024 pixels. Then go to the image icon of the one you want to swap. Get inside and from the image tab, go to System Files and locate the icon you have prepared. Don't forget to change the tap action for that icon. Open the tap action you want to change, then open the Action tab and choose from the list of Apple apps or third-party apps or even shortcuts if you know how to use them. Feel free to tweak the positions of the elements to your liking. If you are more into a flat look, feel free to hide the overlay layers by just tapping on the little eye icon beside each layer. If you enjoyed this video, check out my initial Ultimate iOS Home Screen widget and video, where I cover more than just the widget. We talk about organization, widget stacking, and more. Like and subscribe to the channel, as well as my weekly newsletter if you want to learn how I use my shortcuts. And as always, it's been an absolute pleasure. This is E, over and out.